Good morning to everyone. I welcome you all for the day two STTP program of session one.
Good morning, everyone. I resume my second talk now. So this is on IS 15462, which is the specification for modified bridge. As before, my acknowledgements to AICTE for sponsoring this workshop. And I also acknowledge the management of MNM Engineering College for this invite. The manner in which I have organized my presentation is as follows. We need to basically understand what are modifiers. We also need to understand what are the various international specifications for modified binders. And the IS 15462, the current version, looks slightly different compared to what most of the other specifications have. I will try and highlight that also. And there is also a very important discussion on way forward. So I will try to wrap up all these things within 1 hour. Right. There are, again, as usual, few warnings that I need to give you before I start my talk. Developing an understanding of this modified binder specification requires at least a superficial knowledge of linear viscoelasticity. I am not really sure about the background of most of the participants. So if you are given some terms such as G star by sine delta, G star times sine delta, JNR, percentage JNR, at the face value. As I mentioned yesterday, the whole idea of this kind of workshop is to kindle in you some kind of an interest, excitement about binders, modified binders and bituminous mixtures. But the real crux of the whole thing will involve considerable amount of theoretical knowledge. Without that knowledge, we will not be able to go forward. The testing that is required for modified binders are also fairly sophisticated. There are more unanswered questions than answers. And so we need to take stock of all the situations. And again, I do not really have any answer if you ask a question such as which modified binder is the better modified binder. I have no idea. Okay. So having said all these things, we will start this. So what really are these modifiers? There is basically no fixed definitions for modifiers. In fact, you can just only say that whatever improves the mechanical performance of a base bitumen can be called as a modifier. A filler can be a modifier, an extender can be a modifier, elastomer, in fact, there are at least 7 types, they are a modifier, plastomers, some 6 types modifier, crumb rubber is a modifier, oxidants and antioxidants, they are modifier. Hydrocarbons are modifier, and in fact, in some countries, in some specification system, even the PDA based process bitumen is also called as a modified bitumen, because they will consider a straight run bitumen as an unmodified bitumen, and any process that changes the property of a base bitumen is called as a modified bitumen. You can have anti-stripping agents, fibers, the list is phenomenal. Okay, right. So there are a few issues that we really need to understand before we proceed further. Okay, what really are the issues related to modification? Okay, the first and foremost thing that we really need to understand is what is the warrant for modification? Why should we modify a bitumen? What is wrong with the existing modified bitumen? If unmodified bitumen, if the existing unmodified bitumen can give you enough performance that you are looking for, why should we even modify it? The reason why I am emphasizing on this point is very clear. If you have a pretty good VG30 bitumen for the loading conditions and temperature that you have got, adding an unmodifier to it is not really going to help you, because if you really want the modifier to work, you need to subject it to that kind of a loading conditions. Most of the time, the modifier will work only when it is subjected to that kind of loading conditions, temperature reversals and all those things. So the first thing that you should answer is, what are the loading conditions? What is the temperature that I am seeing? What is the likely failure? And then when I examine an unmodified binder, it is failing in all these things. So I need an improved performance. So I need a modifier. That is number one. Number two is, now having modified it, can I use the same testing procedures protocol that is put in place for unmodified binder? Yes and no. Aging procedures have to be changed. Material characterization has to be changed. Many, many things have to be changed. Even the extraction of the binder from the mixture, if you have a modified binder, may not necessarily give you the same answer that you are really looking for. And the third and the important thing is, how do these modified binders age, or how do their proper time as a function of the radiation that you are really seeing? And finally, how do you really build in a performance criteria for this modified bitumen? Because again, if you are using a modified binder, there are going to be many grades. Okay, so how do we really build in? The very first attempt towards building in performance criteria has been taken by IS 15462 by merely copying from ASHTO. There has not been any background work that has been carried out by Bureau of Indian Standards in doing that. All they did was to just take the ASTM and ASHTO standards related to multiple stress creep and recovery. They have changed those specifications. Hopefully, as we get more and more data, we will be able to go back and relook at it and try and see whether these changes that has been effected will give us the answer that we are really looking at. Then comes the next important questions. What are the various tests on modified binders? There is a basic confusion among the highway engineers. In fact, a few years back, some of the modified binder manufacturers used to say all kinds of things to the highway engineer, saying that, you know, if you have an excellent elastic recovery, it is a very good bitumen. Nonsense, basically. Elastic recovery and all those tests will tell you only about the presence or otherwise of the modifiers. Okay, so there are three types of tests that have been prescribed. First and foremost thing is test to determine the presence or otherwise of a modifiers. You need to understand, as a highway engineer, if I give you two cups of bitumen, one is modified, another is unmodified, there is no way you can look at it and say that this is an unmodified bitumen. All of them will look black. Okay, there is no way you can do that. So you need a test. And the test that was originally designed by Elf Petroleum in those days, now it is part of the Total, is to do an elastic recovery test. The problem is, this elastic recovery test will work only for some kind of modifier. It may not necessarily work for some other kind of a modified binder. That is number one. So test to determine the presence or otherwise of modifiers. Number two, test related to the usage of modified binder during mix production. You have followed a very specific procedure for producing your mix. Can I follow the same procedure? Most of the modified binder manufacturers will tell you, just increase the temperature by 10-15 degrees centigrade. This is based on their understanding of how their binders will work. So you need to ascertain that kind of an information from your modified binder manufacturers. And then third important thing is test to quantify the performance of the binders. So this is the background that I really wanted to have before we start talking about it. And I will be using all these three important points as and when necessary as we go along. So let us now talk about the international specification for modified binders. This is again an Australian specification. It very clearly says in their specification itself, presence of modifiers. So that means these are all the tests that you do to check whether there is a modified binder present or not, modifier is present or not. So a consistency test, a stiffness test, a viscosity test, a torsional recovery test, and then again a softening point test. And there are also something called as TBR, to be reported, some data that test that needs to be supplied, proposed by the supplier. And the Australia does something even very important. They give you the mixing and the compaction temperature to be used for different types of modified binders. In fact, you can actually see there is an A25E, which is basically an elastomeric type of a binder. So what is the softening point? Typical, what is the minimum temperature for final rolling? What is the minimum for effective compaction? What is the maximum for effective compaction, cohesion? So they basically want you to finish your compaction somewhere between 150 to 100. And how much should be the maximum to avoid drainage in open graded mixture? And what is the mixing temperature? All these are given here. And the associated viscosity here is also given for the modified binders. So this is the temperature, mixing and compaction temperature that is given by Australia. Then they separately, they give you that what kind of binders should be used for what kind of classes. If your pavement is going to be subjected to considerable amount of rutting, okay. So, for instance, assume that you are constructing a road in a portion in India where there are going to be enough, you have already seen many failures, rutting resistance, and if the traffic is heavy and very heavy, they give prescribe what is this very heavy and heavy, they tell you to use a A15A. If it is heavy, they ask you to use this. If it is going to be very heavy, they ask you to use this. So similarly, you can say rutting resistance for marginal pavements, adequate pavement. There are different classifications that are given here. So this is the kind of guideline that is pavement engineer. You will find such kind of a guideline very useful for you to pick, because you can pick the particular binder type from here. Then you can go to the mixing and compaction temperature. You can pick what is the temperature at which you have to mix and compact, and again you can also use this kind of a test to find out what kind of modifiers are there, how much they are present, and all those things, right? So this is the story related to when it comes to the European Union. As I keep saying, this is the European Union standard 14023 2010. Okay, there has been a recent revision that this is fine for you. So this actually see here. So they came out with a specification framework for polymer modified bitumen. So yesterday when I was discussing with you their unmodified binder, I said it was a confusion because of many tables that are given here. But when it comes to the polymer modified bitumens, they have done a pretty decent job of it. Okay, so the first and foremost thing is they want you to measure the consistency. Understand this very carefully, these words. Consistency at the intermediate service temperature, you do a penetration at 25 degree centigrade. Consistency at the elevated service temperature, this is with the softening point. Then they prescribe a test called force ductility test. Now this is a very interesting test, because this test can be carried out in your ductility equipment, except that you need to have additional sensors. Normally it is a practice to go and buy a separate equipment. So what it does is, you take your sample, you extend it at a rate, you have a load cell that will measure how much is the force that is required. So as you keep on pulling it, the load keeps increasing, and at the breaking point you get the peak point, and the force keeps reducing. So by looking at the area under the curve, they basically find out what exactly is the cohesion, because the failure is going to be this kind of a failure. So there is a force ductility test that is given here. There is a brittleness at low service temperature is given. There is a strain recovery test, elastic recovery at 25 degree centigrade or 10 degree centigrade, depending on where you live. So you can actually see that for a PMB 45, somewhere around 80 to 60. So this is the different type of test that are prescribed. Then as far as the performance criteria is concerned, they want you to measure, use bending beam rheometer. I will not get into the details about bending beam rheometer at minus 16 degree centigrade, a dynamic shear rheometer measurement at 60 degree centigrade, and then what they really call this deformation energy at different temperatures in relation to the grades to be applied. And the most important is, if you are selling a polymer modified binder as in European Union, you need to attach a test using fluorescence microscopy on the polymer dispersion. You need to talk about the solubility, the handling temperature, and most importantly to me is the storage and the pumping temperature and the minimum and the maximum mixing temperature. So the manufacturer should clearly indicate to you what is the temperature minimum storage at which it can be stored, what is the pumping temperature, because these are incredibly complex systems. They are not simple systems, and unless you get the technical background of a manufacturer, you might pay lot more money. For instance, you know, if modified bitumen is 30,000 rupees per ton, modified bitumen can be 45,000 rupees or more. It all depends on the grade. So you will be spending this much money to buy 1 ton of the material, and if you do not know how to store the material, you make a mistake in storing, you are going to have a problem. And so all this information should be given by the manufacturer, and the manufacturer will help you, assist you in setting up this whole thing. Let's go to US. US is a very, very interesting country because of the advances that they have made as far as payment engineering is concerned. Initially, in fact, when this polymer modified business started, see, there was a big confusion. What happened is the performance grading system came in late 90s, and at that time every US agency, government agency, said, I don't want to care whether what kind of a modifier you use or not, it has to meet our performance grade specifications. And in fact, big modified binder manufacturers left US, stopped producing in US, because they said, no, we really cannot make modified bitumen with the performance grade. This performance grading is insensitive to the modification process. The performance grading system is insensitive to the modification process. You need to have a different specification. They refused. Many PP companies I know that they have left. And then initially, before the PMB, there was four types of specifications: type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4. And then what they did was they withdrew the whole thing. And in fact, the original standard was standard specifications for type 4 polymer modified bitumen for use in pavement construction. They said this specification covers asphalt cement that have been modified by the addition of an appropriate polymer for use in pavement construction. Okay, this specification is not intended to be a performance based specification. This was withdrawn in July 2005 due to lack of use. No, they did not want to use it at all, so they removed it. But what has happened is they kept the rubber modified binder, and the rubber modified binder is still there as a 6114, but I think I have to just check, but it is still there as two types, and you can actually see the apparent viscosity at what temperature they ask you to measure, 175 degrees centigrade. Similarly, the penetration values are given, and again you have two different penetrations, degree centigrade softening point, and there is a resilience that they really want you to measure, right? A plethora of standards have been produced by ASTM after the modified binders started coming in, and they also placed that if you are going to use modified bitumen and if you want to use the performance grading system, they don't really match. So the wisdom came later, and so what they did was, instead of the rutting parameter, which was G star sine delta, so they introduced what is really called as the multiple stress creep and recovery test method using a dynamic shear rheometer. So this was introduced here in D7405. There are various tests that are listed here for as far as the modified binder is concerned. So this is as far as ASTM. Okay, so high temperature binder specification using multiple stress creep and recovery, intermediate temperature binder specification using the binder fatigue test, and low temperature binder specification using ABCD, or what is called as an asphalt binder cracking device, or double edged notch tension test, dent test, and things like that. Okay, so this is a overview of what has happened as far as United States, Australia, European Union, everyone is concerned. So now let us spend some time looking at what India has done. Okay, I will be spending little more time on the multiple stress creep and recovery, because this will kind of help you to understand what is the role of recovery, what is the manner in which the traffic as well as the speed of the vehicle will play a critical role in the development of rutting. Okay, so let us look at IS 15462 and what it really means. The original specification IS 15462 was provided originally by a special publication by IRC in 1993. They called it as tentative guidelines on the use of polymer and rubber modified binders. Then 2002 they released it, but in 2010 what they did was they removed this polymer and rubber and they went into the performance mode. But when they went into the performance mode, they just wanted to take a very first step towards a performance-based specification. So what basically they did was they substituted various test methods that were in vogue with a dynamic shear rheometer based test methods. Let me explain what it is. Okay, IS followed suit in 15462. So they basically had four tables: PMBP, plastomeric thermoplastic; PMBE, elastomeric thermoplastic; and NRMB, natural rubber; and CRMB, crumb rubber. These bottom two material have gone through various levels of controversies in this country, especially CRMB. And NRMB has always been a problem, because this is more location specific, and as a product, because you know they basically felt that in Kerala they had a lot of natural rubber, and the Kochi refinery as well as the government said, you know, we could use this natural rubber and produce a modified bitumen. So this is a problem. Okay, as far as the crumb rubber is concerned, this product is a very tricky product to make. There are a lot of interesting side stories related to this. Since this is a public forum, I won't get into all those details. Let us focus our attention on elastomers as well as the plastomers. And I'm going to just walk you through each and everything very slowly so that you can understand what it is. You may be able to see these slides because the numbers are very small. So I'm looking at plastomer, PMBP. You can actually see there are three grades: PMB 40, PMB 70, PMB 120. This 40 basically comes because of this penetration at 25 degrees centigrade, 30 to 50. So it is what it is. We will focus our attention on this PMB 40. So the penetration is somewhere between 30 to 50. The minimum softening point that you are looking for is 60 degrees centigrade minimum. Now you can leave all this fresh flush point, and if you come to item 5, you will notice one thing. It is written elastic recovery at 15 degrees centigrade, percentage it is given as minimum 30, or the complex modulus value G star by sine delta, this is given as 70 degrees centigrade. Now here comes the most important thing. This G star by sine delta, which is a dynamic shear rheometer based measurement, is basically suited only for unmodified binder. The specifications were proposed by United States, and at that time they thought that G star by sine delta would give you some kind of an deformation in the material. Actually, if you sit down and think about it, the concept is fairly straightforward. But if you really want to learn it rigorously, you need to go take a course in pavement materials or learn little bit of viscoelasticity. What it means is the following. If you take any material subjected to any loading condition, there is going to be energy storage, there is going to be energy dissipation. Okay, so it is like I give you 100 rupees, you put 100 rupees in your bank account, and then you take it out, you spend something like 30 rupees, 70 rupees is there with you. The 30 rupees that is gone forever. So in essence, you can relate it to your energy dissipation. Now, when there is a vehicle that is passing on top of your pavement at, let us say, 60 degrees centigrade, when the pavement temperature is, there is going to be deformation. Now, some portion of the deformation will be recovered. Think of it like a spring. You know, you'll hang a weight, and if you take the spring out or weight out, the spring will go back. But not necessarily in a road, because after the load is removed, there is going to be most of the deformation will come back, the material will regain, but some portion will not regain. Okay, so that has something to do with the dissipation. Now, if you could design a material such that this amount of permanent deformation that you see here is minimized, then you will most likely not have any rutting related problem. And here I am focusing only on the binder part. The aggregate skeleton will have its own role, that we will talk about it tomorrow. Okay, so that is the basic idea. The second thing that you should notice here is, in our IS-73 kind of a specification that you see here, and in fact, you take a look at this first line. It says penetration at a 25 degree centigrade, a value is given, right? You will notice that the temperature here is fixed and the values keep changing. Now, if you look at this particular thing here, you will notice that the modulus parameter, or a parameter that quantifies the amount of energy dissipation in the material, is kept constant, whereas the temperature changes. I want you to really, really understand this very carefully. So, in the first case, the temperature is kept constant, the values change. In the second case, think of this G star by sine delta as a notional parameter that tells you how much the material can dissipate energy. The minimum that you have, the better it is for your pavement. But immediately you will say, no, it is going to be a function of temperature. So what we can do is, no matter what happens, I will keep this energy dissipation to this much minimum. That is given here as 1 kilopascal or 2.2 kilopascal based on the aging condition. And you want this 1 kilopascal or 2.2 kilopascal at different temperatures. So if your pavement 7-day average maximum is of the order of 70 degrees, will ensure that your binder will have a minimum value like this. If it is even 58 degrees centigrade, you are not going to change it. So that means no matter what happens, you are not going to allow for any dissipation that is going to happen in the material. This is the interesting idea here. I mean, we could speak about this over a period of 3 or 4 hours. We can explain it, first introduce you simple linear viscoelasticity and explain it. But as of now, for this course, for this audience, this is good enough. Now, you can actually see there is another parameter, viscosity at 150 degrees centigrade. There are some values given here. This is something to do with the mixing and the compaction temperature. There is a test on short-term aging thing is given here. Again, you can actually see a complex modulus as minimum kept here. It is 70 here. Okay, I am focusing my attention on 70, this thing here. I am also focusing my attention on the elastic recovery and on the portion where it says R. Okay, because this is going to be a plastomer. Now, let us come to elastomer. And you basically see that in the elastomer, there is nothing that is seen here. You only see a elastic recovery that is given here. And the elastic recovery now here is shown as 70, whereas in the previous one, it is shown here as 30. This is a problem basically. Why? Because elastic recovery tells you about the presence or otherwise of the modifier, whereas even if you and I agree for a moment, G star by sine delta tells you something about the performance. Okay. The reason is plastomer will, by its nature, by its design, the manner in which the modification happens, okay, it is not, you are not going to see any tree. If you look at through your fluorescence microscope, you are not going to see anything. You are not going to see a big network or something. So that is how it is designed. Okay. And it can, since it cannot meet the elastic recovery, or a complex modulus value is basically given here. Again, you can see that this is PMB 40, 30 to 50. Many things are given here. The same thing. Let us skip this NRMD, because in my opinion, this is, as of now, it is available only on demand, that too in very specific locations in some states in the country. And in my opinion, it is a poorly designed product, which is not worth spending time on. So we'll go to crumb rubber modified binder. So you will see that there is a CRMB 60, and now this is classified based on the softening point. And you will also notice here that there are no performance properties that are mentioned here. This is the status of IS 15462 2004. Okay, so later many attempts were made to revise it, and in fact I was part of these committees in which we were trying our luck to see how best we can change some of these specifications. So very recently, IS 15462 2019, there was a change that has come. And this particular change that is given here is only for PMB of more or less of the following type: polyethylene, EVA, ethyl methyl acrylate copolymer, EBA, ETB, SBS, SIS, SB and SBR. So these are the various types of polymer modified bitumen that is available here. Now comes the specific deal, the IS 15462 to the new IS 15462. Okay, the first and foremost thing is, need to understand this very carefully. The grading is based on pavement temperature and the traffic. Kind of take a small pause here and kind of try to link you. All of you here, if you are a highway engineer or if you are in highway engineering profession, you will agree that on any given road stretch, a slow moving vehicle causes more damage than a fast moving vehicle. We have to agree on this. Only if we agree on this, we can go forward. You will also notice very clearly that in places where there is an intersection, for instance, you are driving along a national highway, you have to take a turn right side to a small village road where there is a frequent acceleration, deceleration, you will see that the pavement has been damaged substantially. Okay, so let us understand why this happens. When there is a slow moving vehicle, for any given specific distance, the time duration, what you see there, of loading is lot more than compared to a fast moving vehicle. A simple ballpark number that I can give you is, if there is a truck that is moving on a pavement, I can take around 2 to 2.5 meters as the representative area in which you will see that the deformation is really active. So that means if you take your calculator now, if you are driving at 80 kilometer per hour, and if the bowl, deflection bowl is, let us say, 2.5 meters, you will, if you compute, you will find out that each and every point in that deflection bowl of 2 or 2.5 meters, you will notice that it is subjected to a loading for something like 0.1 second. This 0.1 second is, how do you convert it into frequency of loading? It comes to 10 hertz frequency. And in fact, this 0.1 second loading, 0.9 second rest period and all those things comes more or less from this particular picture, right? So now when I am driving at a very slow speed, this load duration now becomes 0.3 second or 0.4 second. So when there is a vehicle moving very slow, it is subjecting the material to more time duration, and the deformation keeps on increasing. That is number one. Number two is when I am accelerating, when I am decelerating, or when I am applying a sudden brake, what really happens? If you understand the logic, and in fact, you should quickly think about how you will react when you are standing in a bus and the driver brakes suddenly. Okay, if it is a live class, I could ask some of you to give your answer, but since this is not a live class, I have to keep talking, hoping that you will catch what I'm saying. So next time, as and when that happens, after this, all this pandemic goes away, when you are driving in a bus, riding a bus, you find out, or when you are riding a car, so let us say you are sitting in the back seat and the person puts a sudden brake, where do you go? Do you fall in the front or do you fall in the back? So all those things needs to be understood very carefully. So what will really happen when there is a braking? There is going to be a load transfer from the front axle to the rear axle. Sorry, from the rear axle to the front axle. Now let us assume that you have a 6-ton front axle legal axle load. There is a real load of 15 tons in the rear. So when you are putting a basically a brake, there is the CG is going to shift, and around 8 to 9 tons from the rear axle, that load will shift to the front axle. So there is not only going to be a load that will have act like this, there is also going to be a load that will act in this particular direction. That is number one. And when you accelerate, what will really happen? The opposite will really happen. Okay, so there is going to be, but that is not really damaging. What is really damaging is the panic braking or braking at, let us say, 50 or 60% of the brake efficiency. So there is going to be substantial amount of load transfer that will take from the rear to the front. And then as the vehicle comes to a stop, this will go from the front to the rear. Okay, so that is typically what will happen during this kind of a loading. So we need to understand this particular thing. Right. So why am I emphasizing on all these things? Because you will notice that there is something called the speed here. And I have picked one specific grade here, and I have an reason for explaining this carefully. So this is your PMB grade 8210, which is having an average maximum pavement temperature less than 82 degrees centigrade and minimum temperature greater than minus 10 degrees centigrade. What they did is they have given you a very simple equation connecting the air temperature as well as the latitude of the location. So if you can collect data, use our contour, it is fine, because this equation that is given is not the equation calibrated for Indian condition. This is a long-term pavement performance data, and this seemed to have worked. Okay, so we need to see whether it will work for our country. So you know the latitude, you know the air temperature, you can compute what is the pavement temperature at 20 mm, because you don't really have to go slightly down from the surface, because at the surface you are going to have radiation and all those effect, right? So IS 15462 now gives you four classifications. There is something called the standard, there is something called the heavy, there is something called the very heavy, and there is something called extremely heavy, right? So what is this standard? And if I say what is MSA, I am going to assume that all of you know about it. If you don't know what is an MSA, you can always wait for Dr. Padma's talk 2 days from now, in which when she introduces IRC 37, she will talk to you about the million standard axles. So if the million standard axles are going to be less than 10, and if the speed is going to be more than 70 km per hour, it is called the standard. Now, all these are not big innovations from India. This is a straightforward copy of the Federal Highways Administration report. Okay, heavy is 10 to 30 MSA. And now you need to notice the difference here. This is not and, this is R. R, 20 to 70 km per hour. And similarly, very heavy is greater than 30 MSA or less than speed less than 20 km per hour. Now, what is really happening here? You also need to notice that these people are also trying to create an equivalence between low speed and high codes are going to be very heavy and the speeds are very low, and somehow that classification is not captured in IS-73. So as an engineer in charge, I take this decision and then I go ahead and use it. So this is going to be very heavy, and you can see that R and extremely heavy is 30 million standard axles and less than 20 kilometers. So this is the most critical condition here. So to summarize, the new IS-15462-2019 as of now will talk only about polymer modified bitumen. There is a list that is given here. Then the second is you need to figure out what is the temperature and the speed. Okay, so the temperature is based on this particular thing, and this is the PG grade that is given here, right? So now if you basically take a look at this particular thing, so let us focus our attention on 82 minus 10. So you take the original binder, do the softening point. Minimum softening point they are looking for is 80 degrees centigrade. A polymer modified binder who knows how to make polymer can easily get 80 degrees centigrade softening point, not really a very big deal. And if I am going to have softening point of 80, the elastic recovery 15 degrees centigrade, they are looking for something like 85. This is going to be a problem. We will talk about it later. Maybe sometimes in the future, viscosity at 150 degrees centigrade, there is a maximum value that is given here. And the complex modulus, basically this is not really complex modulus, this is dynamic modulus. You cannot divide a complex number by a real number. Okay, so this is the mod value. You have to put two lines surrounding that G star divided by sine delta as 1 kilopascal, 25 mm plate, 1 mm gap. All these things are given here. So this is 82 degrees centigrade that they are asking for. There is a phase angle of 75 degrees that they are asking. Basically, the phase angle is nothing but the lag between the applied load and the resulting deformation. Any viscoelastic material will always show a lag between the cause as well as the effect. What is the cause here? When you do a strain control loading, you will apply load in such a way that you will get a sinusoidal pulse. So the load is first applied and it takes some time for the deformation to start increasing, and the difference between the peak load and the peak deformation is normally called as the phase difference, phase lag, and it is given as 75 degrees. You just need to say pi radians 180 degrees. So you need to say when you do a torsional oscillation, you are talking about a sine wave. So you clockwise direction, counterclockwise direction, you finish one cycle, so 2π 360, that is what it is, right? So when it comes to the short-term aging residue, this is given as G star by sine delta as minimum 2.2 kilopascal. It is given as 82. Now comes this test called multiple stress creep and recovery test. So I have indicated only this particular thing. So now I will explain to the best of my ability in this medium in the next 5-10 minutes what this particular test is all about. So there are ASTM specifications, the guidelines for it, ASTO designations, M332 for it. So this is what.
Sorry to disturb you. Slide is not shared. Slide is not visible. Thank you.
Rajan.
Sir, your slide is visible, sir. I think.
You have to pin his name,
ma'am.
Yeah. No, sir. Somebody presented in between, so when by mistake you presented, so what happened when something happens like that, your thing will go in a minimum size, so they have to again pin the screen. That's all.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah.
Please pin the presentation to view it full screen. That's all.
Right, so let me continue. ASTM D7405. Okay, so I will first explain this thing. So what we are going to do is fairly very simple. We are not going to work in frequency domain. We are going to work in time domain. So I am going to apply 10 cycles of one stress level and then another 10 cycles in another stress level. Of course, there is a preloading cycle. I won't get into that. Now, what you will see here is I apply a load 0.1 kilopascal and I am going to look at 0.9 and then I apply the load for a specific time and I am trying to see how much is going to be the recovery and I am going to keep on doing this. Okay, so this is the loading portion, this is the recovery portion. Now let me explain. So I will apply 1 second loading, 9 second recovery, 20 creep and recovery cycles at 0.1 kilopascal, followed by 10 creep and recovery cycles at 3.2. This 20 creep and recovery, the first 10 creep and recovery cycles are for preloading conditions. You can leave it. So let me come here and show you this. This is the picture that you really need to understand. You see that the load is applied for 0.1 second. Sorry, 1 second. And you will see that for the 9 second, there is a recovery period given here. This is the most interesting thing about this test method. Okay, so what it means is you apply a load, the material keeps on deforming, and when you unload it, it starts recovery. Now the point is you would like to use a material that will have a minimum value of this non-recoverable strength. Okay, it will be very nice if you this material could recover as much as possible. Why? For instance, assume that you have a truck that is going 10 cycles of load are being applied, and let us say if this deformation is not recovered completely, what will happen? The next cycle will start here and the deformation will keep on accumulating. You are going to have rutting in the field. So this is the recoverable shear strength. So let us now define few simple parameters. So this is the peak strain, this is the recovered strain, this is the unrecovered strain. So what is your percentage recovery? The percentage recovery is given by this thing. So how much is the recovered strain to the total peak strain is taken as the percentage recovery. Okay, I will give a simple example. The peak strain is 0.3, the recovered strain is 0.197, the percentage recovery is given as 34.3%. So that means 34.3% of the strain has completely recovered. Then we can actually say, so then you will immediately say, no, wait a minute, this is based on the load that you apply. I don't believe your strain. You give me a parameter that will be independent of the load that is applied. So I am telling you there is a parameter called creep compliance. What it means is you divide it by the shear stress. Now this is an interesting parameter. You need to understand. Civil engineers will have a hard time in understanding because you are always used to modulus value, stress by strain. Here what I am doing is I am doing the opposite. It is shear strain by stress. So by doing this, okay, what I get is I am getting a normalizing this unrecovered shear strain as a function of this applied shear stress, and this parameter is really called as JNR. Okay, so now let us go back and look at this specification. So if you see here, you will see that for a standard traffic condition, they tell you that the JNR at 3.2 kilopascal should be maximum of 4.5 kilopascal inverse. See, because this is strain by stress, so you are having an inverse here, and the JNR difference, because we also now want to do the what is the strain sensitivity. See, it is taken as the difference between 3.2 kilopascal and 0.1 kilopascal as a function of this. So in essence, I capture what is the stress sensitivity, strain sensitivity. I also find out how much is the irrecoverable deformation, right? So this is what is proposed here. So let us try and understand this little carefully. So I went and picked up the current US state DOT specification from Florida. So they have given MSCR JNR 3.2, this is ASHTO M332 for different classifications. Yes, it is given here. Now where is this? Yes, we everything is coming from. This is coming from here. Okay, so this is standard less than 10 million standard axles, and So the classification system that you see here, SHVE, is nothing but the American classification system. So when you go and take a look at this one, it says 4.5 maximum, which is what you have also seen in the our specification also. You will see that there is a value that is given here as 4.5 maximum. So we have not deviated anything from what the is given in US. So all we did was we just went and looked at the ASTM or ASTRO specification, copied it here, but we copied it wrongly. I will also show you how we copied it wrongly, right? So this is what we did. Yes, you can see all these values here. JNR difference is given, all those values. Now, for there is something called as high polymer content, what is these days called as HIMA. So they basically said you have to measure it at 76 degrees centigrade. This variations keeps going from state to state, and this information is given here. Now let us check fatigue. Okay, so I did not mention anything about fatigue as far as these things are concerned. Similar to what you are going to see as rutting, wherein you specifically say something as G star by sine delta as something, here it is given as G star times sine delta. Again, you need to put those vertical lines there. This is complex modulus, is a complex number, you don't multiply like this. So it is a vertical, and it is given as max 6000 kilopascal. Basically what it says, in essence, you are trying to limit the damage that happens to the pavement because of fatigue, because you are really looking at the temperatures there. So what is the temperature that is given here? This is given as 40 degrees centigrade. For a material of this caliber, which is given as 8210 here, which you see here, okay, this 40 degrees has been taken by people whoever formulated it, unfortunately, from the PG grading. Okay, so that is where really the thing is given here. And in fact, since I have not given you any homework or assignment, what I really want you to do is to please go and check 6373 ASTM D6373. If you don't have ASTM D6373, send me a mail, or send me a mail to Professor Rajan and he will tell you that. You can actually see G star times sine delta, what is the values that they have given here. What we have given and what actually the originally it is given. So this is for rubber modified binder, high polymer modified binder. You can take 82, PG 82 as coming from somewhere close to 26.5 degrees centigrade, whereas we have given something like 40 degrees centigrade. Okay, so there are issues here. So, but what, to summarize, what we have actually carried out is we have in essence written the specifications for modified bitumen in a much better way, because now we start talking about the traffic intensity in terms of million standard axles, the traffic speed, which has also come here, and we have given precise classifications. We also want the pavement engineer to go check the air temperature and the pavement temperature and come out with a better specification system. So this is as far as IS 15462 is concerned. IRC SP 53, I am not really sure what has happening there. They have not changed much in that. So this is what is given here. They are still at G star by sine delta, which is given here as 76. Hopefully, I think this will come under the PMB 40 kind of a specification system here. But what is very interesting, which I really like in IRC, is they give you precise temperatures for mixing and compaction temperature. Okay, so what should be the temperature of the binder at mixing, what should be the aggregate temperature, what should be the mix temperature at mixing plant, and they, you need to understand that all the compaction should be finished from below above 115 degrees centigrade. The exact temperature depend upon the type and amount of modifier and shall be adopted as per the advice of supplier. So that means if you are going to use polymer modified bitumen in your construction, you should ask the supplier, whoever supplied you, what is the temperature that you should use. That brings us to the most important question, right? So what is basically required for IS 15462? We need quite a bit of test procedures for physical characterization, for presence of modifiers and usage of binders during production. We also need to add lot of data to be reported test procedures. In fact, it should be part of the specification system so that you write it as TBR, so that people will collect the data, record it, and it is not acceptance or rejection of a product is not going to be based on this TBR. So that is something that you need to ask. So the finally, I come to this very simple question. The simple question is, what is the temperature to use for mixing and compaction? For a modified binder, there is, as of now, there is no clarity. Your supplier will tell you one temperature, you just need to follow it. Okay. Why is that the problem? The problem is there is a substantial amount of mechanics that you need to know as to why it is happening. Okay. So most of the modified binder industry will advise you to slightly increase the temperature. Mr. Subhash, who is here or who is going to give a talk in this session, if you ask him, he will also more or less say the same thing. So let us try and see what Asphalt Institute says, and I am going to read it out from the Asphalt Institute specification. It says the Asphalt Institutes recommend that for unmodified asphalt binders, they are basically saying you have to measure the viscosity temperature, and wherever the line crosses 0.28 plus or minus 0.03 Pascal second is taken as the compaction temperature. Mixing temperature is 0.17 plus or minus 0.02. And there are, how to determine the viscosity temperature start, there are procedures that are given here. When it comes to unmodified binders, if they say very clearly, if you use the above procedure to find out the unmodified bitumen, modified bitumen mixing and compaction temperature, they say that it will give unreasonably high temperatures for both laboratory mixing and compaction. So Asphalt Institute, as of 2016, recommends two options. The first option is just listen to the supplier. Follow the recommendation of the supplier. As many suppliers have determined mixing and compaction temperature for their individual products that have proven to be appropriate. They have done their in-house R&D quality control, and they are going to tell you that use my binder, mix my binder with the stone surface temperature, finish your compaction before this temperature. Or there is a document, in fact, it was a almost $500,000 research project to find out the mixing and compaction temperature of modified asphalt binders in hot mix asphalt. There is a DSR phase angle or a DSR steady shear flow. I have put some of the important slides here, but I am not going to explain it to you. I will make this into a PDF file, and it will be shared with the participants who have attended all the sessions by Professor Rajan. And if any of you have any doubts or questions related to that, you can actually ask me. The main reason why we are not able to understand what it is, when the mixer aggregate and bitumen is mixed together, what exactly is the shear rate, we don't know. Okay, so there are four different methods for finding out the mixing and compaction temperature, but for doing all these things, you need to have some rudimentary knowledge in non-Newtonian fluids or linear viscoelasticity. So what I am going to do is I am going to skip 1, 2, 3, and 4, but you can keep it with you, and if you ever understand this or have difficulty in understanding this, you can always call me and send me a mail, and I will be explaining this carefully to you. So all I really wanted to say is learn to respect the complexity. Lhotse says it very clearly. Water is fluid, soft and yielding, but water will wear away rock, which is rigid and cannot yield. As a rule, whatever is fluid, soft and yielding will overcome whatever is rigid and hard. This is another paradox. What is soft is strong. So thank you very much for your time, and if you have any questions, I'll be very happy to take them. So let me just go to the chat box and see what are all the questions that it is there. So
thank you, sir. Participants, those who have any doubts or question, you can just post in the chat box.
Please send your questions in the chat box.
You were explaining of the load shift from rear axle to the front axle, the after effect. I would like to understand more. This is from Srinivas. So what really happens if you are driving your vehicle, if there is an intersection, you put a sudden brake, what will really happen? The CG will shift. When the CG is shifting, the most of the weight from the rear axle will go to the front axle. And as the vehicle comes to a stationary, you know, you are driving at 80 km per hour, when it is coming to 0 km per hour, automatically it will shift back. Most of the time, what you are going to notice is because of this load transfer, so there is going to be a vertical load, there is also going to be a horizontal load. So you will actually notice when you go see your intersection, there is something called a shoring, you know, that the top layer would have completely peeled off from your road pavement. So that causes a lot more damage to the pavement than when you are driving at a constant speed. Okay, so that is something that you need to really understand. And in fact, it can be many things that can be used. Neetu asks, are the modified binder manufacturers started using? Yes, we have even started testing some of their product as per IS 15462 2019. Modified binders can be used in varying course as well as in base course. Yes, you can use it. And in fact, if you understand IRC 37, they want you to use the bottom layer, that is the dense bituminous macadam moss, as a fatigue resistant layer, and it will be beneficial for you if you could design your mix. Okay, right. Now Ranganath asked for PMB 80-10 when any properties are not met as per our requirements, what is the next step to achieve that properties? My God. So you should go and ask whoever is the manufacturer. I guess this is a manufacturer. I know Ranganath very well. So go back and tweak your products. Right. Ambika says, nice presentation, sir. Thank you, sir. Nowadays, nano materials are used. Why nano materials, Ambika? Let us understand some simple material. Those will act as or simply additive. Okay. So I will. If it is acted, the DSR will test. So I will tell you this so-called nano material, you have to be very, very careful when you are talking about the chemistry of it. Some of the nano materials are used to retard the amount of aging that happens in the material. Okay, there are beneficial effects of using the nano material. To give a simple example, forget about the nano material. Take your filler, you add your filler, the interaction between the filler and the bitumen is very complex. What can happen is you can have a coating, you know, it can swell, and in a sense it can give you a stiffening effect as well as it can heal, you can trigger healing. There are some self-healing material that are being used. We can talk about it later. Probably this is not necessarily a venue for addressing all those issues. Srinivas wants to know, there are now technology where they claim the road can absorb water. That is a mixed design process. Okay, so there are, in fact, it is a standard practice in many countries in Europe to lay a topmost layer which can take the water. See, because water splashing when you are driving at high speed in these highways is a big problem. There will be a spray that you are going to see in front of you. So the water has to be drained out. So that is typically a mixed design process. It is a very tricky mixed design process. We will talk about it later, right? What type of binders are used in permeable thirsty pavement? I don't understand what is a thirsty pavement. I am going to assume that whatever Srinivas is asking is what Subin is asking, more or less the same. I think I answered it. It's a mixed design issue. Nikunj wants to say, can we use plastic with modified binder? It is. Plastic means many things to many people, Nikunj, because it can be PPE, LDPE. The basic understanding we need to have is, we have to say, let us go out and be very focused and technical on these things. Low density polyethylene or high density polyethylene will not mix with bitumen. Okay, so if you have to really make it with mix with the bitumen, you need to add many things to it. So what are really called as GMA and all those things, many chemicals are there that need, so you need to actually graft something to this material to make it bond with that. Okay, only then we can actually use it. So plastic means many things, and if you go search for review articles that are published in science cited journals, you will understand the complex chemistry that is involved here. Okay, and Mahalingam says, good presentation, sir. Oh, thank you very much. And are there any more questions, Rajan?
This audience,
yeah, it is there. USA standards, we use SBR latex as a binder. Does it affect the color properties? Why should I don't know why I should worry about the color properties of bitumen? I would like my bitumen to be black in color. Okay, is there any specific reason why you asked about the color? Because this is what you can say. So I mean, I don't know how many of you will understand Tamil here. This is Raja Verde, so I don't want to get into that. Okay, bitumen, let it be black in color. Okay, there is a colored bitumen that is used. No, if you use latex, it will be white in color. Why? All your polymers will be white in color only, right? So if you really want to change the color properties, you have to take the what you can say, take the asphalt in out. The moment you take the asphalt in out, it is oil. Nothing is there in that thing. Okay, and Shell has come out with a very expensive product that called the colored bitumen. They all use it in Europe, very cash rich countries, Austria, Zurich, and all those places where you have this nice park in which different colored bituminous material are laid here. Those things are fashionable and fancy. Let us try and understand how to construct good roads for this country. And Srinivas says, thank you. Thank you very much. Francis says, thank you. Thank you again very much. And if there are no more questions, so may I take leave, Rajan?
Thank you very much, sir. I think it's over.